We have no doubt that we will hit these performance targets. HX50 is clearly strikingly beautiful, but the thing that makes it most attractive to owner-operators is its performance. It's an incredibly quick helicopter, and that's what makes it usable in all areas of your life. But how is it that we've been able to make a helicopter that's so much quicker than its comparables? Well, the thing that you have to understand about helicopters is that many of the early helicopters were simply not designed to fly fast. They were designed for missions that were envisaged around their ability to take off vertically. So a lot of the applications and a lot of the design goals for early helicopters were around utility lifting applications, the ability to get in and out of tight landing sites, less as being a vertical takeoff means of getting from one place to another. And as a result of that, if you look at a lot of the fuselages and a lot of the design attributes from an aerodynamic perspective for early helicopters, you find that very little effort ever went in to making these things streamlined. And the best example I can give you of that is if you think of a conventional configuration of a helicopter, the fuselage is really generally only about 40% of the overall drag of the aircraft, the overall parasitic drag of the aircraft. The rotor mast, just the mechanical parts of the rotor hub and mast in the center of the rotor, often represents about 30% of the total drag. And then the unfaired skids that we often get on the bottom of helicopters can easily be 15% of the drag of the aircraft. So these big mechanical elements that you don't get on fixed-wing aircraft drive the drag of most helicopters and pin us down to very, very low cruise speeds. Now, people are often taught when they learn to fly the helicopters can't fly quickly because of the dissymmetry of lift, because of retreating blade stall and advancing tip Mach numbers. And while all of those things are true, those effects really don't start to hurt you until you're at around 180 knots. And then at around 200 knots, the vibration that results from those things starts to become really prohibitive. And there's a hard cutoff at about 250 knots where it's really not practical to fly a conventional helicopter any faster. The current speed limit is still held by Lynx at about 216 knots for a conventional helicopter, to give you an idea of where these things start to get difficult. So if you wanted to fly a helicopter at 140 knots, that's well below any of those technical barriers. Then it just becomes about how you get the drag out of the helicopter. Now, the first thing you've got to understand is if you make a helicopter look much more like an aircraft fuselage or an aeroplane fuselage, you're going to tend much more towards those sorts of much lower drag levels. And one of the historical examples I can give you of this is some work that was done in between 1959 and 1963, I think it was, by Bell on reducing the drag of the UH-1B, the Huey. Now, they took a standard UH-1B, and then they fared in the aft fuselage, they fared in the vast rotor pylon, they put fairings around the skid legs and made a bunch of other very modest modifications to the fuselage. They kept the same engine, they kept the same rotor system, though they did take the teeter bar off, and they did nothing else to the aircraft. By doing that, they reduced the drag of Huey by 66.5%, and they put 30 knots on the cruise speed for the same rotor system, at the same gross weight, the same helicopter. And so that is the best example that you'll find anywhere of how just taking care of the aerodynamics properly as a fixed-wing designer would is how you can push the envelope of normal cruise speed without needing large amounts of power to do that. And so if you take HX50 as an example, we've got a machine that's about the size of a Gazelle, for example. We're slightly smaller, slightly lighter, but our drag profile, because we've eliminated undercarriage with retractable undercarriage. We've fared all of the rotor system in, including the draggy rotor hub itself. We've been very careful in how we've designed the root of the rotor blades so that the drag is completely minimized, minimizing the amount of power that we need to fly at a modest cruise speed of 140 knots without needing excess power. And that's exactly what we've done, and we are well within the normal range of helicopter performance and aerodynamics. Now, to make sure that we were able to do this, we first used the latest computational fluid dynamics methods to design and optimize the fundamental shape of the fuselage, of the mast fairing, of the rotor head fairing. We very carefully managed and orchestrated the leakage and industrial flows, as I would call them, that feed the engine and feed around all the ventilation system in the aircraft for both the mechanical parts and the cabin, to make sure that we don't accumulate big momentum losses when we're using that flow to work within the aircraft. And then we've designed a rotor system that is designed to fly at these higher speeds. We use modern RC3 and RC4 series aerofoils that are about 17 to 20% more efficient than the traditional aerofoils that are used on helicopter rotors. We've got a parabolic swept tip to minimize the impact of higher speed flight. The whole helicopter is set up to operate specifically at this point. And then importantly, we've set the aircraft up from a flight dynamics point of view to fly level. So the mast is tilted 5 degrees forward. We've got a large horizontal stabilizer to make sure that the aircraft sits horizontal in high speed forward flight, presenting the lowest projected area to the flow, unlike a lot of other helicopters that sit very nose low and present a lot of the top of the fuselage to the oncoming flow, increasing their drag. Now, we don't just rely on simulation for these things. The aircraft fuselage itself was tested back in 2019 in the wind tunnel to validate the calculations, and the calculations and the wind tunnel measurements correlated very, very closely. The basic rotor topology that we're using is a formula that's well known in the industry, and very similar rotor topologies, very, very similar rotor planforms and aerofoil distributions are in service on existing helicopters at the moment, delivering this level of performance that we're relying on for HX50. So in terms of the forward flight performance, it's actually very, very simple what we do. Get the drag down so you don't need as much power to fly fast forwards, and then set the aircraft up with low drag and a level cabin attitude to fly forwards comfortably. And then our main rotor design uses composite rotor blades to carefully manage the structural dynamics of the rotor in higher forward flights and keep the vibration down to a minimum. But from a fundamental performance point of view, we have no doubt that we will hit these performance targets. The hover performance is a much easier argument. The machine has been designed with robust lifting capability, as well as the performance margins that we've stated from sea level all the way up to 10,000 feet on an ISA plus 15 day. And there are lots of other comparator aircraft out there with similar powers and similar gross weights and similar rotor diameters and solidities that shouldn't give anybody any concern that the aircraft can perform exactly as we say it does.